In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins, and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, St. Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. After our Lord spent the morning in Capernaum, teaching at the synagogue, healing, before that, as he entered Capernaum, healing the servant of the centurion. Then when lunch came, lunchtime, he went to the house of Simon Peter. And Matthew recounts, and when Jesus entered Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law, the mother-in-law of Peter, sick with a fever. He touched her, and the fever left her, and she rose and served him. Nowadays, pilgrims are brought to a church which is built on top of that house. It's a circular church. Those of you who have been in UP, you know how a circular church looks like. It's something like that, but elevated from ground level. Because ground level was, of course, the house of Peter, of Simon Peter. So they built it on top of that. And there before the altar, if you go forward to what should have been the communion rail, there's an opening in the ground with plexiglass, so you can see through to the excavation, to the house, the layout of the house of Peter. That's what happens when you go to the Holy Land. You see the things of the gospel. And there's a reason why Scott Hahn, making use of words of some of the older, but it was from him that I heard it first, had called the Holy Land the fourth gospel. You have, or rather the fifth gospel, because you have the gospels according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then John. But then you have the Holy Land itself, the so-called holy places, which, if you go there in the attitude of a pilgrim, not a tourist, in the attitude of a believer, not just a gawking, shall we say, buyer of artifacts or of souvenirs. If you go there prepared to pray, even preparing yourself spiritually by going to confession beforehand, more if you're accompanied by someone who can guide you through those places, make these considerations that we're making right now. Go deeper into the meaning of each one of those events that transpire there, then something happens. Because those places, those stones, those remains speak to you. In a way, like sacred scripture speaks to you, almost. That's why they can be called the fifth gospel. And you come out of there renewed. And you will never read the gospel. You will never consider the mysteries of the Holy Rosary. You will never go to Mass and listen to those things the same way again in your life. They leave a mark in the soul. And sometimes you wonder how this poor priest can make these passages come alive so much. It's because I've been there 5 times. And God willing, I may be able to go back there again and to lead some of you even who have been clamoring for another trip to the Holy Land once this pandemic is over. Well, Capernaum is one of those places that you enter. Of course, they have commercialized it, right? You have to pay something to enter. But then in the entrance, there's a sign, Capernaum, the city of Jesus. What a claim, right? Because come to think of it, even if Jesus Christ spent 30 years of his hidden life in Nazareth, most of his public life was spent in Capernaum. That was his base of operations. Among other things, because at that time, Nazareth was an inconsequential place, out of the way, tucked in the mountains. Nobody goes there. While Capernaum is at the crossroads. It's in the western side, western shore of Galilee, very close already to the north-south road there, going to Lebanon, skirting the Mediterranean. There was a lot of foot traffic there. And if you go there, you'll see the size of the synagogue that had been left behind there. And so that was the setting. From the synagogue, he had walked over, going towards the lake, and there was the house of Simon Peter. And what does he find? The mother of Simon Peter was sick. And what more natural thing to do than to heal her, right? As the mother-in-law of your best friend now. By that time, they were already a band of brothers. They were already constituted into the College of the 12. They had been moving around together, spending days and weeks and months together in an uninterrupted interaction that would take them a little bit over 2 years. Now, the amazing thing here is, if we see the context of this event, there had been a miracle with the centurion. There had been the synagogue and all that discussion. Most probably the discourse on the Eucharist happened that same morning too. And now, famished, lunchtime, he finds himself with no food, not yet, and with a sick person. He attends to her. That's how our Lord was. That's how a priest is. And you, my brothers and sisters, by virtue of baptism, have a priestly soul. Have you ever wondered what that character is that we learn in the catechism is imprinted in the soul of the baptized? That character which is indelible and which makes, therefore, baptism non-renewable. Once you're baptized, you're always baptized. You don't have to do it again unless you really renounce your being baptized, which nobody really does. They just become born again, but they don't renounce their Catholicism, their baptism. And so when they come back, and hopefully they should come back, they don't need to do anything special. They never cease to be Catholics. They never cease to be Christians, rather. They have always been baptized. Anyway, going back to this, that character is really a participation in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? Jesus Christ is the eternal high priest. He's the mediator between God and creation. By participating in that priesthood, we too are constituted priests. Not to be able to say the Mass or to configure the sacraments, but rather to act in a priestly way, to be a mediator between God, the Blessed Trinity, and his creation. As we have considered in the past, with that downward motion of that mediation, which is our working and disposing temporal realities according to the mind of the Creator, which on the other hand, we understand because we're prayerful. We understand because we're obedient and docile to it. It becomes a way of life for us, the kingdom of God amongst us. And then that upward motion, that world which came out beautiful from the hands of God, which had somehow been disfigured by the perfidy of men, 5 billion of them, at least the environment around us, what we can reach, we put back in order, we fix, not just spiritually, everything, whatever fixes the human condition is redemption, is co-redemption, and then we can offer it back to God. With that attitude of a priest offering incense, of that priest offering the sacrifice of the Holy Mass. I remember many years ago, one of the the first center that I was a director of there in my 20s, talking to students from UP, how I could see their eyes open up wide when I would tell them, you know, that if you are a son of God, if you are in his presence, if you're aware of your divine filiation of your and of your priestly soul, when you move in front of your workstation, and let's say that time there were no workstations, rather the lab, the technical table, the physics experiment, you will move through it with the same sentiment, with the same feeling that a priest should have, a good priest should have, moving in front of the altar. That is your altar of sacrifice. And Jesus Christ was aware of that 24/7. And that's the reason why the way he moved amongst us was always with that attitude of implanting the kingdom of his Father and offering it to God. Everything that he touched, like King Midas, was converted to gold. You and I, everything that we touch must be converted to sacrifice. Not suffering sacrifice, but sacrifice offering, like incense rising up. But as you know, didn't end there. That because it says, the fever left her and she rose and served him. Oh my God. Nothing is extra in the Word of God written in sacred scripture. And we thank St. Matthew for having mentioned that detail. Because at first blush, okay, imagine that. She was sick with fever. She was aroused from it. The normal, normally people would not move after that, right? Your mother would tell you that you'd get a relapse. But she was a mother. Everything, the buck stops here. And so she served him. I would have thought, oh, him alone, how about the apostles? They came together with Peter, the son-in-law. I suppose she did that too. I would even think that there was really food there for them. She didn't have to cook. That would be too much. She just came out from a fever. Remember that Peter had a wife and a family. So there was meal there for them. They were expected because the synagogue from the house is just a short, 100 meters. They knew what was happening the whole morning. They were expected. But she served him. To serve, meaning to say, to be attentive, to wait on him. Again, you know, we're living in a world where there's, thankfully, altruism. The natural tendency to be good to others. Yes, of course, there's a natural tendency to be good to others. I mean, some people have become so skeptical that they think this is a cruel world. It's not. It's just imperfect. And people are not normally cruel. They become cruel when they're crueled on, so to speak, no? And it has to take some time because one, shall we say, raw deal does not make a person cynical. All right, people are good. And so therefore, people have this idea of solidarity, of social awareness, and there are schools there, for example, where they have the students, you know, it's part of the deal, it's part of the system, the social immersion. They live with the squatters, they live in payatas, they really get into social immersion, which is good. But all of those, if they're not based on a more fundamental reality, which is love of God, of which it should just be, those should just be an overflow, then they're fake. They can't last. And there's a reason why a phenomenon like that, moved many times by emotion, altruism, precisely, it's almost like, I wouldn't go that far, it's pakitang tao, it's just show. No, it would be genuine altruism. But altruism doesn't cut it. Because when altruism comes face to face with self-interest, altruism goes out of the window. There's only one thing that trumps self-preservation, self-interest, or pride. And that's a greater love than the love of self. And that has to be the love of God. So Peter's mother-in-law, who was never named, sometimes I wish they had put the name there. What was her name? Eustachia or something like that. Well, not Eustachia, because that's not a Jewish name. That's already Greek. And they were Jews. But in any case, she showed the way. As Mary, later on, the younger sister of Martha, would show the way. Jesus first. She chose the better part. She served Jesus. As you and I should serve Jesus. If we want our altruism, we want our good deeds, if we want our social awareness to be genuine and to last. But that wasn't the end of the scene. That evening, remember this was late after lunch already. When they had lunch, it was already late. That evening, they brought to him many who were possessed with demons. And he cast out the spirits with the word and healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities and bore our diseases. Remember, I told you once that Matthew was the evangelist who was addressing his version of the gospel to the Jews. And his, avowed finality, his purpose in writing his gospel, was to prove to the Jews the genuineness of Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, was the Son of God that had been foretold in sacred scripture. So that many times that phrase would be repeated, that it was in fulfillment of what was spoken of in the prophet Isaiah, or some other scripture. And this is one of them. He has taken our infirmities and borne our sorrows. When you look again at the context, it had been a long day. It had been a tiring morning, not just the curing of the two cures. But what was really tiring there was the session in the synagogue, you know, to be grilled by those Jews, the scribes, and even the Pharisees there. But at the end of that day, when our Lord should have been resting, to his surprise, all the town's people had brought their sick, all those possessed by demons, and he cured them. Because that's what a priestly soul finds himself or herself in many times. How many times you're all disposed already, you planned your day, and oops, your children need this, your husband needs this, or a friend is in need. What do you do? It's not the time for that. It's already, I have my own schedule. Well, sometimes you can't help it. You have to live order, right? You need time to eat, you need time to rest, you need time for other commitments. And so therefore, this next one that is coming in, you'll just have to say, sorry, I cannot attend to that now, I'm full. But at other times, when what is at stake really is just something very, very personal, as your own time to relax, to watch Netflix, or to, I don't know, do sports, then maybe those things have to go, as our Lord's rest had to go that afternoon. Non recuso laborem. That was the motto of an elderly religious who, at the ripe age, was kicked out of his congregation, the congregation he had founded, one of those things that happened in history. But then when crisis came and they couldn't fix anything. They took him out of retirement, I suppose, sheepishly begging him, asking for forgiveness. And that's what he said. Non recuso laborem. I do not shirk the task. My brothers and sisters, help me pray that all of us priests have that motto engraved with fire in our heart, if not inscribed in something that can remind us of it. Like, I don't know, in the door of our house, or in the inside part of it, or in the inside of our bedroom, so that when we step out, perhaps even grudgingly because we have been called, we see it. Non recuso labor. I do not shirk the task. Because that's the cross that the Lord Jesus Christ is asking us to carry for him. He's carrying the greater part of it. But we're Simon of Cyrene, who have been asked, let's not do it grudgingly. One can imagine that Simon of Cyrene must have started with a bit of resistance, because the gospel does say that they had to force him to help Jesus carry his cross. You don't force someone who's volunteering, you force someone who's resisting. But one can only imagine what happened. Carrying that cross, perhaps initially grudgingly, feeling the heavy breathing, the collapsing strength of this man beside him, realizing, because he was not ignorant, he knew what was happening in those days, that this man was carrying the burden for us. And why not say it? He had already been transformed, because our Lord was doing all that to save mankind. And here is a friend. Of course, he was the first recipient of those graces. He ended up embracing that cross, embracing our Lord, throwing his lot totally with him. So that a little bit later, that's the way he was written. He was referred to as Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Look at that phrasing. It meant that Alexander and Rufus, his sons, was well known in the Christian community, such that the reference to him, or rather his identification, was on the basis of that fame, of that reputation, of that prestige of his sons. And everything started with that meeting. Our Lord did not shirk the task. As we, you and I, can never shirk the task. No need, no pain, for not to say no joy, of the people around us, the people we know, should be alien to us. In Tagalog, we have a wonderful word that has no direct translation in English and in all the other languages that I know, and I know quite a number. It's malasakit. Malasakit. It's not sympathy only. It's not, I don't know what, commiseration. Malasakit is a lot more, because it has both negative and positive. The capacity to share in the joys, and also the capacity to share in the sorrows, is that identification with the other. And that's what we need. And that's the reason why it has to be supernatural. Because only God can really do that. He loves everyone, because all of us are his children. We tend to love what is lovable. And in order for us to love a person who, at least on the surface, is not lovable, we have to penetrate that veneer of unlikableness, that veneer of defectiveness, that veneer of woundedness, in order to see the core that God loves. And that is the priestly soul, which is what really I wanted to transmit in this consideration of that morning of Capernaum, or that day in Capernaum of our Lord, a typical day of giving and not saying enough. because that's another motto that a priest should have. First is non recurso laborum, I will not shirk the task. And the second one is that, never saying enough. St. Jose Maria at a given moment would say, you know what really is the mark of a priestly soul? Never saying enough. Numquam satis, never saying enough. We have to end. You know who are the people who never say enough, really? Mothers. I'm so convinced of this. The reason why a family works such that people are feeling good enough to be good, because don't you realize that you're good when you feel good? It's an overflow. What makes people in a family well enough to be good? To feel their need for affection, their personal needs, satisfied enough so as to overflow into care for others. It's because there's someone who is the real caregiver, the affection provider, the attention provider for all of them. And that's usually the mother, who in the first place is a wife to her husband, who is a crying shoulder for her daughter who may have a heartache there, or a son who's having all kinds of crazy ideas, or a younger boy, an adolescent, who is naughty, who needs help. So she's there doing homework, engaging the teenage daughter with her kikai stuff, and then the older son maybe with, I don't know what problem he has, and the husband, of course. And in order for her to be like that, as somebody once said, paano na lang yung kaligayahan ko? And you know, that's the reason why I think women are pious. Because where else are you going to get the love, the balance, and the anchorage if you're not pious? You get it from our Lord. For as long as the Filipino society functions like that, where you have pious women, and hopefully the men too, become pious because of that, then we will weather all these storms. The house, the family will be strong, and the children will grow up in that environment of love such that they too learn how to give themselves without holding anything back, without limit. And that's what Jesus Christ is. You have a few minutes left to end the prayer.